Can there be music more instantly recognizable, more wildly popular, more beautifully scored? Pyotr Ilyich Tchaikovsky's 1876 ballet Swan Lake is nowadays considered a classic. Captivating audiences with its haunting oboe theme and shuddering string accompaniment, the work has found a home not only in the theatre and concert hall, but in popular entertainment, film and television. Who among hip-hop fans can forget the music box version of the Swan Lake Suite sampled in Beyoncé's 2016 studio album Lemonade? Who among film buffs can ignore the live-action performance of the ballet that features prominently in Darren Aronofsky's 2010 psychological thriller Black Swan? This is not to mention the puppet shows, circus adaptations, and computer animations aimed at a younger audience, including the popular 2003 straight-to-video release Barbie of Swan Lake. Certainly, Tchaikovsky's ballet has found an enduring place within the classical music canon, that imaginary museum of great works, as well as within the wider cultural consciousness, our collective musical memory. A huge theatrical achievement, Swan Lake is thought to have redefined the status of music in ballet, long considered second rate, not to mention the status of ballet in a theatrical scene traditionally dominated by Western European grand opera. But even a cursory glance at the historical record paints a more complex picture. For when Swan Lake premiered on the 4th of March 1877 at the Bolshoi Theatre in Moscow, having been commissioned in 1875 by the Russian Imperial Theatre Directorate, it received a frosty reception. The dancing by the Czech choreographer Julius Reisinger was unimaginative. The principal role, performed by the company's second ballerina Pelagaya Karpakova, was unconvincing. The conductor, Stepan Ryabov, appeared insecure on the rostrum, and the stage designs by Karl Waltz, Acts 2 and 4, Ivan Shangin, Act 1, and Karl Gropius, Act 3, lacked inspiration. Critics also commented negatively on what we might describe as Swan Lake's pick-and-mix structure. While ostensibly new and original, the work featured dance movements borrowed from other ballets, detached from their intended context, and interpolated into the loosely stitched fabric of the new danced drama. But perhaps most shocking, at least from a modern-day perspective, was the criticism aimed at Tchaikovsky's score. Yes, almost 150 years on, we might find much to praise, beginning with the abundance of melody, always elegant in contour, charming in spirit, and perfectly balanced in phrase length and form. Then there is the music's atmospheric moodiness, expertly captured by Tchaikovsky's vivid orchestration. This is not to mention the composer's mastery of musique dansante, a style influenced by French ballet composers Adolphe Adam and Léo Delibes that seems to complement and even inspire physical motion. Swan Lake, as we so often read in CD sleeves and program notes, offers a perfect synthesis of music and movement. But back in 1877, critics held an almost diametrically opposed point of view. Far from graceful and poised, Tchaikovsky's music was thought too complicated for dancing, too Wagnerian in style, too symphonic in scale, and simply too loud. What is more, the relationship between music and choreography seemed strained, not harmonious and empathetic as we might expect. Indeed, there exists no historical evidence of the nature and extent of any collaboration between Tchaikovsky and Reisinger. A critic for the St. Petersburg News reflected on the perceived discrepancy. In some places, soloists and corps de ballet are positively at odds with the orchestra, and you see that it could not be otherwise. The melody is too, how can I say it, too confused, too capricious. In a word, it was not written balletically. The disjunction is obvious, not only between the music and the dancing in the ballet, but between our present-day perspective and that shared by members of the audience at the premiere. Interestingly, this tension between viewpoints extends to our understanding of Tchaikovsky's musical personality, his creative identity, and artistic appeal. While it is almost universally acknowledged that the composer was very much an individualist, he avoided alliances, turned his back on manifestos, and crafted no compositional recipe for others to follow, the essence of his music has been hotly debated. Some listeners have found Swan Lake and other full orchestral works to be fundamentally European, couched in the grand symphonic style of German composers Ludwig van Beethoven and Robert Schumann, while injected with an intense dose of drama, as in the programmatic music of Franz Liszt and Hector Berlioz. Others have found Tchaikovsky to be an ardent Russian, his music invested with a primal quality and intense national fervor, a perfect embodiment of Slavic culture and folk traditions. Yet another group of listeners has thought that Tchaikovsky, ironically, was not Russian enough, that his music, some distance from the primitive crudity favored by his contemporaries, known as the Five, was irrelevant, failing to embody an authentically Russian national character. A further group, particularly critical of the composer, has pointed to intemperance and overkill, decrying Tchaikovsky's music as guilty of the worst excesses of Western Romanticism. Self-indulgent melancholy, out-of-control passion, irrationality, and hot-headedness. This is not to mention the legions of Tchaikovsky fans who have long listened to the composer's music as biography, daring to find connections between the composer's art and his life, in particular his seemingly fragile character and his sexual orientation. Legions of books and articles have been written about Tchaikovsky, the man and the music. The two, it seems, are irrevocably intertwined.